गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. टुडेस टॉपिक इज अबाउट द इंफेक्शियस डिजीज डिफ्थीरिया पर्टुसिस एंड टेटनस. दीज आर द मोस्ट कॉमन इंफेक्शंस वी जनरली सी इन पीडियाट्रिक एज ग्रुप. ओके, सो फर्स्ट वी स्टार्ट विद डिफ्थीरिया. Diphtheria is caused by the Tournibacterium diphtheria. There are two types of diphtheria there. So this is respiratory diphtheria and cutaneous diphtheria. This diphtheria is endemic in our India, but the incidence of Tournibacterium diphtheria is gradually declining in our country. This is mostly as we see the incidence was 12,000 during the 1987. But it was reported only the 4,000 cases during the 2013. So the incidence of diphtheria is decreasing because of we are using the immunizations actively. We are giving DPT vaccination to the all children, all newborns. So this is why that the incidence of diphtheria is decreasing in our country. So this is the slide show. This is the slide showing the Tournibacterium diphtheria, Albert strain. These are the metachromatic granules we can see at the ends of the diphtheria bacilli. It is gram-positive and non-motile bacteria, and this bacteria does not have any invasive power, so it will stay on the top of the mucous membrane only. All the clinical features are because of the toxin which is produced by the Tournibacterium diphtheria. There are four types of diphtheria bacilli: Gravis, Mitis, and Belfonti and Intermediate. These are divided based on their cultural characteristics. The pathogenesis of all these four are similar only. So there is we cannot differentiate clinically. These are only the cultural characteristics only. So this is the slide showing the pseudomembrane of the diphtheria, which is generally seen over the pharynx and the tonsils. The bacilli multiply locally only in the throat, and which will elaborate the exotoxin. These exotoxin will cause the localized tissue injury, and this localized tissue injury leads to formation of inflammatory surface around the and a formation of a pseudomembrane, which is, this is the pseudomembrane on the top of the tonsil and the pharynx. And this infection associated with the same as usual, any infection, regional lymph nodes, lymphadenopathy is there, and along with symptoms of toxemia. The epidemiology, the agent, we know the Tournibacterium diphtheria, and the source of infection is generally from the cases and the carriers. The cases are, the cases may be the subclinical or clinical cases. The carriers may be the temporary and the chronic carriers. Out of the carriers are divided into nasal and the pharyngeal or throat carriers. These nasal carriers are very dangerous because through the nasal, small droplets of infection will spread to the nearby people. So nasal diphtheria carriers are very dangerous. They will spread the infection to the other people. So the infected material is nasopharyngeal secretions. And also there is entity called cutaneous diphtheria. So the discharge or secretions from the cutaneous diphtheria also cause the infection. So period of infectivity generally ranges from the 14 to 28 days. Post factors are diphtheria is more common during the preschool children age group, 1 to 5 years only, the preschool age. And it is equally affected in the both sex. And environmental factor, the incidence of diphtheria is more common during the winter season. Maybe the low temperature will favor the spread of the infection by the droplets. And the mode of transmission is droplet infection only. And very rarely it may be transmitted from the cutaneous secretions by the cutaneous diphtheria, and also very rarely it may also transmitted by the contaminated surfaces, and incubation period is 2 to 6 days. These are the clinical features. So we divided the diphtheria into pharyngeal, tonsillar, laryngeal, nasal, So these are the respiratory involvement of the diphtheria is divided into three: pharyngeotonsillar, laryngotracheal, and nasal. So pharyngeotonsillar diphtheria, pharyngeotonsillar diphtheria, it generally involves the pharynx and the tonsillar surface. So it generally present as a sore throat initially, and which is followed by difficulty in swallowing and associated with fever. On examination, we can see the pseudomembrane formation and tonsils. So as the disease progresses, there will be severe edema of the submandibular region, and neck regions, anterior parts of the neck and the submandibular region. So this is, we call it as a bull neck. So the diphtheria causes bull neck appearance. And laryngeotracheal diphtheria, as is the diphtheria may also involve the trachea. Below the pharynx, there will be a larynx and trachea. So the laryngeotracheal involvement of the diphtheria is very dangerous. This is the very dangerous form of the diphtheria. Because of laryngeal and tracheal involvement, the pseudomembrane and the inflammation may obstruct the airway. So it will leads to the cyanosis and hypoxia. And the laryngotracheal diphtheria associated with hoarseness and barking cough. This is the barking cough we see in the diphtheria. And in case of laryngotracheal diphtheria, the toxin may produce the Naruda. The diphtheria toxin will also cause the paralysis of the soft palate and ocular muscles and the extremities. So generally, initially the patient presented with difficulty in swallowing or difficulty or drinking initially because of the pseudomembrane in case of pharyngeotracheal. Because at the end of 2 to 4 weeks, because of the toxin, the paralysis, neuroparalysis of the soft palate muscles will occur. It will cause the difficulty in drinking water or anything, eating. So nasal diphtheria. The nasal diphtheria is a very mild form, but the problem is that this nasal diphtheria is highly infectious. So the patient with the nasal diphtheria easily spread the infection. So cutaneous diphtheria, it is generally common in the developing countries. It is very rare in developed countries. And it is more common in the places where overcrowding is there. So this the patient with cutaneous diphtheria does not develop the severe form of diphtheria like pharyngeal diphtheria, but they spread the infection to the other person. So after spreading the infection, after receiving the infection, patient may get the severe infection, but these patients won't get the severe respiratory infections. So this is the cutaneous diphtheria image. This is also called a desert sore. So the patient is immune to diphtheria or not, we can clinically diagnose by doing the SHIP test. In this SHIP test, there is small amount, 0.1 ml of the diluted diphtheria toxin is injected. This is the site of injection. In this one lip, the toxin is neutralized by heating with high temperature. After in this, the active toxin is given. So if the patient will develop a erythema or erythema swelling at the site of active site, the patient is susceptible. He does not have any immunity towards the disease. So this will tell the susceptibility of the infection, susceptibility of the person. And we can diagnose by microscopic examination. We have to remove the pseudomembrane and we have to send for microscopic examination. And we have to do the culture and bioterping and antibiotic sensitivity. And toxicity of the diphtheria strain will be demonstrated by ELIX test. So this is the ELIX test. In this ELIX test, this is the first in a medium. In the centrally, we put a strip which contains diphtheria antitoxin. After that, we have to place the. This is the. And non toxic, what we extracted from the patient. So, this is the unknown patient. So, we have to incubated 37 degrees for 24 hours. Then if you see the, these are the streaks. So these are the streaks. So these are the streaks will appear. These are the streaks will indicate the diphtheria bacilli is producing the toxin and which is neutralized by the antitoxin. So these strain does not produce. So these streaks are not seen in not toxigenic diphtheria. So this is useful for demonstrating the pathogenicity of the infected diphtheria bacilli. And control of the diphtheria, any disease, we have to first early diagnose the early detection of the diphtheria, and we have to diagnose the cases and carriers very early by simply going to the school and we have to examine the all the children. So this is more common in the preschool and school children. So we can easily diagnose those. And isolation. So all the infected patients should be isolated for 14 days. And or else at least two consecutive throat swab should be negative for diphtheria. And treatment. This is the diphtheria antitoxin. Generally, we have to give early pharyngeal or laryngeal. We have to give 20,000 to 4,000 international units. So moderate nasopharyngeal diphtheria. We have to give 40 to 60,000. In case of severe extensive laryngeal diphtheria, we have to give 80,000 to 1 lakh international units. These have to be given by IM route. And along with the antitoxin, we have to give the penicillin or erythromycin for 5 to 6 days to clear the infection. So vaccination, also we know that vaccination, the diphtheria, generally the single diphtheria vaccine is not available. It is mixed with the pertussis and tetanus vaccine. So there are 5 doses are required. But initially, the first 3 doses given at 6 weeks, 10 weeks, and 14 weeks. And first booster dose will be given at 1 to 1.5 to 2 years, and second booster dose at 5 to 6 hours. So unvaccinated children above the 7 hours, we have to recommend the tetanus and diphtheria. The pertussis vaccine is not required for the individuals more than 7 years old. So pertussis, this is one of the most common infections seen in the preschool children. So the pertussis is caused by the Bordetella pertussis, which is called as a 100-day cough. That means the infection will last for at least 10 weeks. So in non-treated person, so that's why it is named as a 100-day fever, and it is very contagious fever. Initially, this disease is characterized by mild fever, which is followed by a cough, and the cough paroxysm will increase, and there is characteristic whoop. Whoop means after forcible coughing, there will be sudden inspiration of the air, so it will produce a loud sound during the inspiration. That's why we call it as a whooping cough. And along at the time of that, during the severe coughing, patient may land up into cyanosis, vomiting, and sometimes in the children may develop a rib fractures also. Along with the diphtheria, the incidence of the pertussis is also decreasing because of active immunization. So epidemiology, the cause of diphtheria is caused by pertussis bacteria, and this is the gram negative cocoid bacilli. This is the gram negative cocoid diphtheria bacilli, pertussis bacilli. The source of infection is usually only, the source of infection is from the infected man only. There are no extra human sources not available, and bacilli infective material is nasopharyngeal secretions from the infective person, and it is a primary the disease of the preschools and infants only. The incidence is the disease is more common among the females than the males. And another factor, it is also along with the diphtheria, it is more common during the winter and the spring months. And mode of transmission is by the droplet infection. Incubation period is 7 to 14 days. So clinical feature, there are 3 stages of pertussis infection is there. Initially, catarrhal stage, it is characterized by lacrimation, salivation, sneezing, coryza, anxiety, and cough, and paroxysmal stage is characterized by a paroxysmals of cough, which is sudden onset severe cough, which is followed by the deep high pitched inspiration, and convalescent state, which lasts for 1 to 2 weeks. After that, patient is treated. So diagnosis generally, we have to take the nasopharyngeal swab. This is the method. We have to take the nasopharyngeal swab, and we have to cultivate the border general medium. And treatment, this Bacillus pertussis erythromycin is the best drug for the treatment of pertussis infection. The given dose is 30 to 50 mg per kg body weight. 4 divided dose we have to give in for 10 days. And if we give during the catarrhal stage only, the patient will, if we start the treatment after paroxysmal stage, the clinical course won't change that much. So vaccination, this is given along with DPT vaccine, 3 doses of DPT vaccine given at 6, 10, 14 weeks. And another booster dose is given at 1.5 to 2 years of age. Tetanus. This tetanus is caused by the Clostridium tetani. This disease also because of exotoxin produced by Clostridium tetani. These exotoxin produced by Clostridium tetani, the tetanotoxin, which will cause the muscular rigidity, persistent muscular rigidity, with in between there is painful paroxysmal spasm of the voluntary muscles. And the clinical features, because of muscular rigidity and the spasm of the masseter, we call it as a trismusser large, and the spasm of the facial muscle we call it as risus sardonius, and muscles of the back and neck we call it opisthotonus. This is the picture. There is sustained contraction of the facial muscles, and this is the contraction of the spinal and the neck muscles, opisthotonus position. The source of infection, generally the bacterial spores of ubiquitous, they are available in the soil and during the animal feces also. Generally the bacteria present in the gut of the many animals. So it is excreted through the feces, and the contamination of the wounds by the spores will cause the infection. This Clostridium tetani is gram-positive anaerobic spore-bearing organism. Spores are terminal only, so the spores are generally seen at the terminal. And this is anaerobic bacteria. They grow in anaerobic environment and produces the toxin, which is called tetanospasm. And the reservoir of infection, generally the natural habitat, the organisms are abundant in the soil and the dust. Age, it is more common during the active age, 5 to 40 years. So this is the stage most of the persons will get the infection, because this is the age where the person will easily get the usual traumas. And this is higher incidence present in the males, but females are more exposed during the delivery and abortion. So which is the condition leads to the puerperal sepsis. And occupation, which is more common in agricultural workers, because of their more prone for injuries. So tetanus neonatorum, which is occur in the neonatus patients. So patient land in opisthotonus position. This is generally seen in the infants born to the mother who is not vaccinated against the tetanus. Because the vaccinated mother produces the antibodies, they will protect passively the newborn. And also the infection of the umbilical stump also causes the tetanus. And cephalic tetanus, it is a very rarest and usual occur because of trauma to the head, including skull and basal fracture. The paralysis of the facial nerve, it is associated with paralysis of the facial nerves. And the prevention is by giving the tetanus toxoid, TT injection, which is generally given at along with DPT. And the treatment, so whenever so we have to divide any patient by ABCD. A means the patient had got TT injection within 5 years. B means patient got TT injection 5 to 10 years. And C means patient got TT injection more than 10 years back. And D means his immune status is not normal. So any patient with clean wound less than 6 hours of age, this ABC, A patient does not require any injection. So more than 5 years up to the 10 years of age, so we have to give tetanus toxoid. So if the patient does not take the TT injection, so we have to start the complete new course of TT injection. So in other words, to contaminated, in case of contaminated wounds or following the road traffic accidents, we have to, the B patient, B, for A, the TT vaccine was given within five years, patient does not need any active immunization. So patients who are vaccinated 5 to 10 years old, he need one dose of TT toxin. But if it is more than 10 years, we need TT one dose along with tetanus immunoglobulins. And if the patient does not have any history of TT injection, we have to give TT complete course along with the human tetanus immunoglobulins. So tetanic immunoglobulins, tetanus antitoxin is the treatment for a tetanus, and antibiotic treatment like metronidazole is preferred antibiotic for the Clostridium tetani. And the muscle spasm can be controlled by giving the benzodiazepine. The diazepam we have to give in by 5 milligrams and lorazepam 2 milligrams. This will control the painful spasmodic spasms. In case of severe tetanus, we have to give severe tetanus like ophysthotonus, or with respiratory compromise or active spasm of the respiratory muscles, we have to inject a immunoglobulin intrathecally, and we have to do the tracheostomy to save the to prevent the obstruction of the airway, and also we have to use the magnesium sulfate. It will control the spasm automatic dysfunctions, and diazepam also helps to relieve the painful muscle spasms. And if there is any autonomic dysfunction, is there autonomic dysfunction will cause hypertension or hypotension or hypothermia, we have to give by control the hypertension by labetalol and magnesium and clonidine and nifedipine. These will prevent the autonomic storms. Okay, this is the class, and thank you very much.